Hey, we also have here in the studio with us today, he is hands down the smartest man in this room, White 90. Why you gotta fuck up my shit? Here in the studio with us today is, he is hands down the smartest man in this room.
And the shortest.
When White 90 has a life question, this is the man he calls. He is a father, a husband, a hero, a surfer, and one of LAPD's finest. It gives me a great honor and privilege to introduce LAPD officer Jason. Dude!
What's up, Jay?
Hey, kids.
What up, bud?
What's happening?
All right, Todd. All you, buddy.
All right, so today we have in the show today is an old friend of mine that I went to high school. I know it kind of seems like we're having a lot of friends.
Well, here's the thing I was talking to him about. So we've had the mayor, Pookie, on.
Yeah.
We've had Miller on. We've had you. And so it looks like James Hatfield and the Carpenters aren't the only thing to come out of Downey.
That's right.
Right? I mean, you guys are making your mark. That class of what?
91.
Class of 91 has made their mark in the city, or as Pookie, in the country. I mean, you guys have spread out. You guys were a close knit, and you went this way, and now you're back this way. It's really cool.
Yeah. So anyway, we are, you know, it seems like, you know, we're just using our network of friends to, you know, to kind of fill guests on the show. But with this guest, he happens to be an LAPD officer, and he's kind of involved in what we do on a night-to-night basis, and we see each other. I mean, I don't see Jason while I'm working, but, you know, this is why we're having the conversation. So Jason is here joining us, and Jason used to work for as soon as you got out of training, let's start there. When you got out of training for being a police officer, where did you go? Why did you start? In what year did you start training?
So in 1994, I started to get an inkling for a real job. You know, I was working at Downey Music, musician at night, teaching saxophone, like, really hustling and trying to make some money, and the $180 I was making a week just wasn't cutting it for rent, and, you know, just a lot of mac and cheese and working late nights at the bars.
Yeah.
I was over it. So a lot of our guys in our crew were going for the fire department. We had friends like Steve Miller and Brad Brown, and they were really pushing for that. So I thought, well, I could be a firefighter. I wouldn't mind doing that. Every kid wants to be a fireman. So
As a kid, did you want to be a police officer?
No.
Okay. I was wondering that. No, I know.
No.
Thank you.
I had an inkling to help people, but as a police officer, no. I wanted to be a fireman.
Okay.
So in the 90s, there was the affirmative action thing going around. It was real heavy then. And I got laughed out of the Downey Fire Station because I was white.
Right.
They just weren't hiring white guys anymore. They said, good luck, pal, whatever. So I come to L.A., I check the apps here. They weren't hiring white guys either. So somebody's,
they weren't hiring white guys.
You know, my ex-wife at the time, you know, she was interested in getting on the job as well. So her dad was a cop. And I started thinking about it. Maybe I could do this. This is a good thing. And, you know, just it was a perfect storm of circumstances. People around me, the bass player in my band, wanted to be a cop. He was going to go take the test. I went with him, and then my ex-wife was applying for the department, and here I go. Why not me? Yeah. So I apply for the department.
1994.
And I go take the test at LAPD.
And it's a written test before you can walk on to go to the academy to then become a cop.
Yeah.
So what does the written test involve? Is it an aptitude test
or
a general knowledge test?
General knowledge. Just making sure you could write a paragraph, you know, with a decent
format. That'd be tough for me. Right? Run-on sentences?
Listen, this is how you write a paragraph. You tell them what you're going to tell them. Then you tell them what you told them.
Got it. I'll remember that. Right.
You never, ever forget it.
Right. Tell them what you're going to tell them.
Then tell them.
Then tell them. And then tell them what you told them. Got it. That's good. Kids,
MIT, are you listening?
Huh? We're going to get...
Straight to Oxford. Go, Toddy. You got this, buddy.
I'm smart. I know stuff.
S-M-R-T.
Yeah.
I'm smart.
I know stuff. Okay, so you take the test in 1994. Where do you take the test at? Where do you go to take the test?
Wilshire Police Station.
Wilshire Police Station. Is it a room? Is
this
like a room
they
put
like,
you in?
I think it was like a roll call room, and they had a bunch of people there, and they hand out the test, and you take it. And turn it in, and a week later, they'll call you or send you a letter. Hey, you passed. This is the date of your oral interview, and you got to go and you get an interview with, it was, at the time, it was with a civilian and a police officer.
Mm-hmm.
So you go interview with them, and that's – it's strange with city interviews. They're kind of scripted. They want you to hit these talking points when they ask you, so you have to be prepared for it.
Yeah.
Well, I prepared.
Yeah, I'm sure
and,
you did.
They said, you know, the only way you're going to get a shot at this is if you get 100 on this test.
Out of what?
100.
What?
Oh, I think if you had military background or something like that, you could go up to 104 points.
Wow.
Yeah, it was nuts.
Jesus Christ, that's hard. I mean, that's a big number to hit.
That's a big number to hit.
I don't think I've ever got 100 on anything. So I mean, come on. It's just, I mean, that's hard to do.
It is tough. So I dress up as Joe Republican postal worker.
Right.
You know, navy blue, red tie, go in there, nail the interview, 100.
Alex T. Keaton, right.
That's right. I go, this is it for me. I'm in. I'm going to make this. Our friend Jaime.
Yep.
He goes, takes the test. I think Jaime got an 84 or something like that.
So the 100 mark is there's some give, there's some wiggle room there. Yeah? I mean, said he scored an 84. How do you know that?
He told me.
Right. Okay, so he scored an 84, so he didn't need to score the 100 to get in because he obviously got in. He's an LAPD officer somewhere or
right.
was.
I don't know if it was a concern for Jaime.
Oh, okay, so that had to do with the affirmative action.
He's a fine cop, by the way. I missed that guy. I haven't seen him in a long time.
Yeah.
But he's doing really well, from what I understand.
Still in the force?
Still in the force. Sergeant?
Oh, wow. He's sergeant somewhere.
Yeah.
Well, hey, Jaime, if you're watching the show, we'd like to, you know, get you down here sometime, you know? Talk about.
You got to get him here. It should be me and him.
Yeah.
I haven't seen the guy in forever.
We're going to get a love couch, I think, there for when we do...
Chaise
lounge or a love seat. Or, so when we do double... we're going to start doing doubling up, double firemen, double cops, double FBI, you know?
Right. They go to triple when you're done with that.
Right. Three ways. Three ways. So, okay, back on the thing. So you take a test. You pass the test. You go down and take your oral. So you, when you get hired on, you go to MTA?
So here's the deal. I'm applying for LAPD, and a year goes by, almost a year. It's been like 10 months. I got to come back every month to headquarters, listen to a presentation, say, get ready for your background interview, get ready. Every month I was coming, and my friends were getting hired, you know, people I was testing with. And I just said, this is for the birds. So,
Just real quick side note too. Were you testing with? Did you and Cochran go together, or did Cochran go after you?
So Ryan Cochran's a friend of ours that we grew up in high school with. His dad was a legendary cop here at Southwest Police Station. Randy?
Randy, wasn't he part of the crash unit? Or weren't those that was the Andersons?
Can we talk about the big incident that his dad was involved in?
Who, Randy?
Yeah. The North Hollywood shooting.
Oh yeah, well, yeah, of course.
I mean, Cochran's dad was down there at the North Hollywood, the two gunmen with the AKs.
Yeah, right? Yeah, that was nuts. What was that, 96, 97?
Something like that, yeah. Look that up, fact check us. Huh? Hollywood shootout. Put that in the Google search bar.
Search bar.
So you go down for 10 months now. You've been going back and forth every once a month to see what the hiring's going on, what's going on.
Right.
And this is, and you want to go on LAPD.
Right, LAPD's it. This is... You know, I kind of know LAPD. It seems exciting, seems fun. They were, you know, LAPD was the high watermark for police work. And we thought, well, what do I know? Let's get hired here. And by the way, you're throwing a bunch of spaghetti against the wall. Why not try for a department that's 8,000, 9,000 strong?
Are you also trying to apply, like, you know, for Mayberry or outside of Los Angeles?
No, I hadn't. So I got some guy turns me on. He says, hey, man, dig this. You've been applying for LAPD. There's this new department called MTA Police Department. They're going to be like the Metro Police Department in New York. They got federal funding. They're going to blow up. It's going to be the next big thing here in LA.
Well, let's not use the word blow up like that. You know, they're going to be huge. Huge.
Can you cut that out? Somebody cut that out?
Yeah, we'll cut that out.
I am Arab, by the way.
And we know.
Don't need that.
And we don't probably don't need that either.
Oh, are you being serious about the cutout?
No.
Okay, good. I was like, shit, Terry, look at the numbers.
So MTA, the MTA department, who was not around at the time yet, they're saying that they're going to build this department and this might be a good way to go.
Well, yeah, they were around. They were, you know, 210 strong or something like that at the time. And so what happens is they start this big hiring push. So they're looking for people. So I go, I apply for them, and 3 months later I'm in the academy.
Oh.
It was great. So right at the beginning of 95, like I shook hands with the chief of police from MTA Police in 94, in December. And I remember maybe you and I went to a Vegas trip in February that year, and I was like,
nobody remembers Vegas trips.
Yeah, it's good.
It's true. They all kind of blend together. Yeah,
they're all kind of
interstitched.
It's nuts.
So in 95, you get your chance to become a police officer.
Well, so I get hired with MTA Police, and they put me through the police academy. And they send me to Rio Hondo Police Academy in Whittier, at Rio Hondo College. Now, there are people that paid their way to go into the police academy, hoping that after they get out, they'll have their certificate and they could just go work for a police department.
Oh, you can go that route too?
You can go that route. It's risky.
So you're saying I could right now, after the show, I could go
I don't
and put
know
money.
If you could.
Yeah. I got skills. I could jump a fucking wall. So you're saying you could go that route? You could pay to go through police training, get all your credentials, and then go start applying for people going, look, I did this?
Right. Guys do that for the fire academy as well. So there's two benefits to that. One, from a hiring standpoint, the department will look at you and go, okay, cool, we don't have to spend $30,000 on this guy.
And motivation.
Right. He's already done it, or she's already done it. Let's hire him. Get him on the force without having to put that extra money into the training and all that other stuff. We just have to teach them policy and procedure for our particular police department.
Yeah.
Same with the fire academy. And a lot of dudes went to fire science college, whatever, to climb the 10 stories with a hose on their back.
Right, right.
And they didn't have to
backdraft. Doesn't Kurt Russell teach that class? Is it Kurt Russell?
Was it Baldwin?
Baldwin. Baldwin and the Russells. Right. So.
And Ron Howard too.
No, I think he just directs.
I was happy days.
Cut
that out,
so,
Scott.
So you
cut it out.
So I'm throwing softballs.
So then, they say, hey, let's go. They give you the shake and they go start training for MTA.
Right. So they shake my hand. They said, we're going to pay for you to go to this police academy. And, I started getting a paycheck every 2 weeks. It was great.
You're getting paid to go to the academy?
Getting paid to go to the academy. I was on payroll.
That's awesome.
How long is training?
Our academy was 4.5 months, and then we had another month in front of that at our department. And then, so it's about 6 months, like, training in the classroom and trying to learn policy, procedure, law, all that other stuff. And then it's another year probationary period on the streets.
Are you training with anybody you know?
You mean at the academy?
Yes.
No.
No, okay. Because I know you ended up being partnered with somebody you knew, so I didn't know if you guys went through it together or not.
Our mutual friend Ryan, was in the academy right in front of me. So he was academy class right before me, but he paid his way to go to the academy.
Oh, that's okay. So Ryan did that. He went that route.
Yeah, he did that. So
knowing he's going to get a job because his dad is who his dad is. So that's why.
Yeah, Ryan,
right? I mean, nepotism is, or sonotism.
Is he using that word right, Jason?
Nepotism, yes.
Yeah, okay.
I don't know if nepotism works on big police departments. The hiring process here is so nebulous. There's so many pieces of paperwork. You can't just go to the lady at personnel and say, hey,
slide this in.
Put this on the top. They're not having it.
It happens in fire though, right?
How would he know? How could he talk against that?
You
kind
of know. Well, you can't.
I don't know.
Can't.
I don't.
You don't need to answer that.
Maybe.
I've heard.
Yeah, those guys are miserable animals. Hiring all their friends and family.
Right.
Sorry, guys.
So
it's like longshoremen.
Right. Hey. Let's keep it nice for the longshoremen, okay?
Yeah, we're gonna have a meeting here soon.
Oh, is he coming in? I can't wait to see that interview. Let me write that down.
So write that down. So Cochran or Ryan was right behind you, or right in front of you, said.
Right. So, yeah, I mean, for the listener, the viewer, you could go to the police academy without being hired by a police department. You just pay your own way through it.
Do you know roughly what that is?
Nowadays I couldn't imagine what it cost. I know back then it was maybe $5,000 or $6,000, which that's a king's ransom in 90s money. Right. What is that worth today? Look that up.
Google that.
$48 million.
You got some Howard Stern math
going
on right
47.
There.
47. Close.
So another question before Scott jumped in here on that. Do you see anybody get weeded out from the academy process that's just not going to make the cut?
Yeah, first day is, it's like the movies you see, boot camp for the military. I mean, they're up in your business. And
boot camp's one. Let's just go back to like Police Academy, the movie. They let every one of those guys into the police force.
I know.
They made it.
Congratulations to them. So, one of them's a lieutenant now.
I think they made it six times, right?
And they made it six different times. I believe that movie. Six different times. Horrible, horrible. The first one was good. I would say Police Academy was good. The first one, yes.
It was amazing.
Right.
The dude that did the sound effects.
Jones.
Have you heard him online? He has this video out. He does like Stairway to Heaven.
Yeah.
It's the best thing I've ever seen in my life.
All right. We'll check that out. So
cut the tape.
So
I'm part of this.
So you do get weeded out. The Academy does weed out people day one, day two, right? You're just not making the cut.
Well, I mean, there were a few people that walked out day one of our Academy that, you know, paid their way to go to this school, and they didn't. I don't think they were prepared for how intense it was.
Whether it's like physicalities, they couldn't make it. Mental, you know, there's a lot of. Both those things come into play.
I had a hard time. Look, when I was getting hired, people say, "Hey, you know, start running."
No, I remember you guys when training. I remember you guys when we'd come over and hang out at the houses afterwards. I mean, I remember you being spent. I mean, just trying to jog and exercise and keep your, you know.
It was nuts. I couldn't eat enough calories. I was gaunt, like I just exhausted all the time. It was a stress fest, but you know, it is a game, and that's what I think people should really understand that. It is a game. The instructors are there to crack you. They don't hate you. They just don't care about you.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Right, right.
They wouldn't burn calories hating you.
Right.
But they
right.
But they do want to see what you're made of, you know, test your mettle.
Okay, so you complete the Academy. You pass the Academy.
Right.
And you walk on to the MTA force.
Right.
What year is this?
1995.
You became...
And how new are they at that time?
They've been around for a while. They had a contract with the federal government and the county. Remember RTD?
Yes.
Yes.
So they had a small police department then. But when the LA Metropolitan Transportation Authority took over, that's when they got big funding to set up a police department.
Right. Yeah. And so Metro Police Department, Metro Policing is basically all the, you know, the transits, the trains, the buses,
right,
that kind of thing. So that's the beat that MTA handled. And in 95, I mean, the green line on the 105 was, you know, up and running. But there's not a lot of trains. It wasn't the system we have now of the, you know, the subway system in Los Angeles now.
Right.
And the subway systems that are watched by police departments now, it's sheriffs, right, Scott?
It's sheriff. And yeah, sheriff's department.
It's all sheriffs, right?
Not for long, though, but we'll talk about that in a minute.
But for right now, it's sheriffs that handle the Metro beat for all the Metro transit
stuff.
Yeah,
so federal law mandates that a police department, wherever your transportation company is, like the LA County Metropolitan MTA,
yeah,
they have to have police on those systems. They have to either contract them or have their own police department. That's part of them getting their federal funding. That's part of safety for, you know, transportation, public transportation.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they had their own police department. That was the thing. So I was out doing it. You know, I went straight to Watts and started working there 4 a.m. to 2 p.m.
That was your first beat, right?
That
there?
Was my first beat.
And what was your beat? So Watts, what are you taking? Is that the green line? Are
that
you
was
on
the blue line.
The blue line.
So I was on the blue line. And I would ride that from 7th and Fig down to, like, Pacific Station in Long
uniform
Beach.
Or street clothes?
Uniform.
Okay.
So we're in uniform, and it's just, you know, the standard blue police uniform.
Right. And so, you like, when Scott says you're riding the bus, so basically you're full uniform, you know, gun, badge, everything, handcuffs, and ready to go. But you're obviously the public can see you. You're not trying to conceal who you are on the train. You are a police officer riding the Metro Transit system.
Yeah, and then there's laws to enforce there, you know, like the
tagging,
the chicken ass stuff, you know, like not so much tagging, but no cussing, spitting, drinking.
Come on.
You know, that kind of stuff.
You can't enforce that.
The hell we can't. There was a
but
lot.
I mean, did you? I mean,
you know what? It was one of those things, man.
You
that's
can't
a, what's
chew gum
the worst
on
thing
here.
About.
Stop.
Did you bring enough gun for everybody? Did you bring enough gum for everybody?
Are you going to share? This whole train is gumless, except for you, sir. I tell you what. Why don't you stand in front of the train and chew your gum while everybody watches?
There you go, huh? From 39th.
You need to, yeah,
it was
over
117.
You need to run for the chief. Your ideas are great.
I know, dude. So it was awful. There was these cats that were just like, you know, bone tired, just getting up for work, and they have their coffee and they're sitting on the train. excuse me, sir, you can have coffee on the train.
Oh, it's not, so you had to be that. I mean, you,
I was that guy.
You were that guy for
on probation. You
sure?
Had,
yeah,
you I was like, yes, man. Sir, no, sir, in a Jiffy Pete, right?
Right. Yep.
So, oh, it's awful, man. And but that's why the MTA system here in LA, especially, you could eat off the ground at the subway.
Right, yeah, they, I mean, are, they are clean. They were,
when MTA police was there.
Some of them have a fragrance of, what would you say, urine, but they are clean for the most part, you know? I mean, but I mean, even Europe has a strong smell of urine in all their subways too, right? So they're no better than us.
It's so ubiquitous now that if you smell fresh air, would you? What's going on? What's wrong?
What is that? What's happening?
What is that? I mean, it's poison! It's poison!
And like you didn't contribute to that pissing.
I peed in a few subways down in the Eastern European bloc once or twice.
Well, isn't it expected there?
I've never peed in the subway down here in Los Angeles, so you never find me doing that. You know, never. Never. So, okay. So, MTA. So, how long did you work the MTA system for?
So, I was working the Blue Line train for maybe 6 months. After that, I got in a patrol car and started working streets. So, when you'd see MTA police, you're going, "Well, what's this? Yeah, it's a black and white." No, people
guys,
were like,
"Yeah, you guys' cop cars did look like movie set cop cars. Like you didn't quite look like. I mean, everyone knows what a sheriff looked like. Everyone knew what LAPD looked like. But your patrol car was like, what
oh, it's
the
bizarre.
Fuck? Jason just come off of a fucking movie set.
Yeah, what is this?
That? Yeah,
one door was white. Only one door. I remember correctly. I think only one door was white. The rest was black.
Right.
It was a strange car, but I mean, they're police cars. Here we go, rolling down the street with shotguns and everything.
Yeah.
And your mission was you like drive down Pico and clean it up. And there's a lot to clean up on Pico.
Sure.
So that's what we did. Anything near a bus stop, anything on the street, anything a bus would pass by, you were not safe to commit a crime. I mean, you just
you got that was your guys' beat. Like
that
you
was
said,
it.
You're taking care of everything that the bus goes down and goes by. You see any nefarious activities going on the bus routes?
Yeah,
you're handling it.
Right. So, what happens in 1996? There's this chatter about, well, the MTA doesn't want to be in the police business anymore. It's too costly. There's union issues that they have to deal with. I don't exactly know what it was, but the LAPD and the Sheriff's Department came calling and said, hey, we could police the city, the buses
the
and
transit,
trains. Yeah. We could do it. How about us? And MTA board says, well, let's find out if our officers would like to go to those departments. Would they be opposed to a merger with these police departments or the Sheriff's Department? So they come to us. They say, "Hey, you guys want to split off and go to LAPD?" We vote yes. Yeah, let's go. Let's go have.
Is it kind of a unanimous thing? Does everybody want to go?
Yeah.
Or are you having a good time working at MTA? Is
we're
the pay
having
well?
Everything's great.
Right.
The pay is well. We had ex-LAPD officers on our department going, "Hey, you know
right.
what?"
And, this is, and now I'm not trying to say that the beat's not as heavy as being an LAPD cop, but I mean, you're Metro Transit. So I mean, did you kind of settling into what your day to day was, right? Instead of a bigger picture, like being a city cop with having to, you know, kind of police everything.
Well, there was that kind of super troopers feel to it, like, "Hey, here come the transit cops. What
right?
do they do now? You know what?" For the most part, it was great. We got along with all the departments we worked in. You know, we were working in five counties. I took calls down at Disneyland sometimes.
No kidding.
Yeah, it was a good time.
I mean, that's how far you traveled.
Right.
Because working for MTA, like you said, you are in charge, but you guys are patrolling basically where the buses take people.
That's exactly it.
And trains and that stuff. So you have to go where the calls are.
Up from Zuma down to, like, South Orange County.
No kidding.
Yeah, it was pretty wild. So if a crime was committed on the bus, of course, the police department that was near would go handle the emergency, but the investigation
would be you guys.
Yeah, that portion was left up to us, so we'd get down there and get.
Okay, so 96. So when do they merge? What happens?
So 97, November 97, half our department goes to the Sheriff's Department, the other half goes to LAPD.
Did you get a choice?
I didn't. I wasn't high enough on the seniority.
No, oh, was there choices?
So, yeah.
There was.
So everybody that had seniority kind of went to the Sheriff's Department.
Really?
Yeah, for the most part. They're like, I want to go work LA County Sheriff's. It was an easy switch, I think, because of the our pension system lined up with theirs, and I don't
Sheriff's Department.
Yeah, okay. They're kind of easygoing guys, so they kind of, I guess, they perceived the Sheriff's Department as an easygoing place.
easier transition.
You know, it's so long ago, 20 years ago, man. I can't.
I know. I don't. Well, that's what you're here for. We're digging all this up, man. This is therapy, dude.
Look, I need to get this out.
Hey, get some tissues over here.
Indigestion, actually.
Right.
Egg McMuffin on the way in. What you eat at 4 in the morning is awful.
What are you talking about? Egg, 2 Egg McMuffins on the way over. I know
you. Dare you, sir. Cut that out, Scotty. Anyway, so we come over. I come over to LAPD, and they start this transit police division. This is very exciting for all the listeners, right?
It is.
It is, actually.
I'm sure there's a handful of kids just
write this down.
Just piled around the old radio like the FDR days, just listening how you become a decent cop.
Gather around, kids.
It's relevant now because it's now changing back over, and that was just announced yesterday, wasn't it?
That's right, sir.
Yeah.
So we think that we're going to get the contract back with the MTA police. Or not MTA police, but to police the transit system. LAPD.
LAPD is going to
get it. Yeah. The Sheriff's Department did it, and I have no idea, so I'm speaking out of my ass. For whatever reason, the MTA is done with them and wants to hire us. So we're going to go there and police the transit system again. So there was a transit division at LAPD for a long time where I worked. And that was cool. That was a good place. That's where I kind of got my feet wet with patrol. So I went to Southwest Police Station when I got here.
When you transferred over from MTA?
When I transferred over.
Now, were you still doing the same thing, just different uniform?
Yeah, we had – I think we
but
just –
when you were still getting on the trains and doing the job you were doing the day before, you just are now getting paid by somebody different.
Getting paid by somebody different, okay. Different uniform. That was the same thing. They handed us a different gun and badge, and that was it. And said, go do it. And we did it and kind of did some cross-training with a lot of divisions in the city, and people came in, and it was good for cops.
Still uniformed, right?
Still uniformed.
At some point, you were ununiformed on these things, were you not?
Yeah, so okay. I go to Southwest Police Station, kind of get my feet wet in municipal police work, which is, you know, domestic violence stuff and going into somebody's house and trying to break up arguments and giving fake divorces to people.
Right. City call. I mean, yeah, I get it.
Yeah, that got old quick.
Yeah.
That got old really quick. Because, you know, the thing is, the thing about police work is that you're forced to get in people's business. And
well, yeah, that's what you guys, that's what it's all about.
Yeah,
putting your nose in where it doesn't belong until you guys get called.
And, yeah, so you don't get called later.
Right.
So it was tough. It was, you know, an eye-opening experience to go into somebody's home and, you know.
Yeah, get involved.
Take them into custody because they're smacking around their wife or whatever the thing was. I mean, they deserve to go to jail, but.
Absolutely.
Right. You know.
We don't condone anybody putting hands on a lady here at this.
Don't hit a woman even with a flower.
What? Yeah. Never with flowers.
I'm sensing somebody here smacked a chick around. That's what I'm getting, Toddy.
Good.
And I'm going to get to the bottom of this. Yeah, let me write after the.
We're getting to the bottom of this.
Number two.
We're all going to be interviewed.
Number two, interview.
That's funny.
We're all being profiled here, by the way, probably by this guy.
Not allowed to profile.
What? Oh, you guys don't profile?
No,
huh?
We don't profile.
All right. All right.
Well. Not racially, but behaviorally, I can.
Right.
So that twitch in your eye, that's starting to bother me. You're not looking at me in the eye either.
I'm looking just off the eyes.
Grinding your teeth.
Urgh.
Oh, terrible stuff.
So when you get to doing the municipal policing, after that, I mean, like Scotty kind of hinted at, you were doing some undercover stuff for a minute, were you not?
That's right. So I go to Southwest Police Station, and before I leave, I apply for this little section within MTA Police called GHOST. So GHOST stood for Graffiti Habitual Offender Suppression Team. And they were pretty well-renowned throughout the country because of the work they've done. And, you know, these guys – now bear with me because I know you guys are street artists.
Yeah.
Well –
yeah, I'm staring right at you during this. Let's
the daggers.
We have
buddy.
Another Downey tie-in for that too.
Oh, we do.
Yeah, Spoo. Is that what it was? Is that what it's called?
By the way, you know what your tagger name is?
Wait, mine? Do you know what it is? Is it on file already down at the
station? No. There's a way to figure it out.
Oh, well, I thought his was Loud Labs.
No, it's too long. Loud Labs. That's a lot of. I mean, you're never gonna get that on a freeway overpass.
How do you know?
You want to bet?
Really?
No, not really. Go.
Spoo. Hold on a second. Spoo. Isn't what? What's his name?
Yeah,
Thibodeau.
Did we just give up him now?
No, he's publicly. Yeah. He's public.
I was telling you, remember we were talking yesterday.
Is the head dude.
Jason goes, you should have Ron on because Ron, his brother's, we went to high school with again. And he's like, you know, he'd be interesting. And on the text message,
I like them both.
I said, Mike would be more interesting. He goes, yeah, you're probably right.
Yeah, no, I've actually done some work with him. He found out some news, but he's the head of almost what you're talking about, but in a different thing now. Like, if you tag on an MTA or you tag on the freeway,
right,
he's going to come get you. Well, not him, his team is.
I think his team took over what Ghost was for the Sheriff's Department.
Yeah, it sounded the same. All right, go ahead.
Thibodeau brothers, good guys.
Yeah.
Boris twins, by the way.
What?
The Boris twins?
Yes.
Amy and Yana. They got inducted to Downey High School Hall of Fame or something like that.
There is one?
Yes. I'm very upset that I wasn't part of that.
What?
I've been competing with those girls my whole life, and finally I have a chance to shine, and they take them over me.
No kidding.
I don't know if they put their handprint in like some cement or something like that. But
we should look into that, because if there's anything going on in Downey, that's a Hall
of
Fame. That.
Number three.
Look into Downey Hall of Fame status.
Anyway.
So you apply for Ghost.
Hall of Fame?
Hall of Fame. Or Hall & Oates. Either way.
No, Carpenters.
Carpenters and Metallica.
Yeah.
James Hetfield. I have that yearbook with Hetfield in there.
Yeah.
Are you in it?
No,
my brother is, though.
Oh, wow. Nice.
Yeah, not bad, huh?
No, not at all.
I don't want him to die, but that's going on eBay the day he does.
The yearbook?
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
Hey, Daddy's got to pay rent.
Yeah, well, he's
super healthy, so he's probably going to outlive all of us.
He's such a great dude.
Yeah. Have you seen his podcast with Rogan? Him and Hetfield? That was great, man.
Oh, it was
great
really
interview.
Good.
Great interview. So let's get back to Ghost. So when you're on the Ghost team, what happens? What are you doing?
So Ghost, we were undercover cops.
How many of you in the squad?
We were as high as 18. I think when I was on, there was 14 or 15 of us.
Mm-hmm.
There were two sergeants and a bunch of cops. And they said, okay, guys, dress down.
Just real quick. Yeah,
dress down looks like that.
Well, no, but just to
interject. That's a little fancy.
Just to interject, though, real quick, during his undercover days, Jason and I, you know, we've been friends and hung out and been friends for this long. Some of Jason's undercover outfits, I think, if I'm correct, he was taking a shirt here and a shirt there and picking up a little bit of my style. I think you kind of, right? Am I right?
Well, did I not get some XXX agent stuff? Was it at
that
time?
Did your shoes match your shirt?
Yeah, tops and bottoms, baby.
Tops and bottoms.
Didn't lace them either.
Right? Yeah. No, I know. You had a really good look. So let's go on. So I'm sorry to interrupt you. I just wanted to know that I think you were taking my look a bit here and there on some days while you were working. Just saying.
Write this down.
Four.
It's weird because I saw Jason the day Kurt left for the wheelie trip.
Yeah.
He looked like that.
Yeah. No, absolutely.
He had a red flannel on. He had red shoes on.
Did you like working in the undercover detail?
Yeah, it was good.
Yeah?
Next question. Great interview. Do you like doing stuff? Are you having fun in life?
Do you like chasing the bad guys and putting them in jail?
Those pants you wearing, buddy?
Come on.
Okay, listen. Yeah, I did. It was a good time. So we got all these young cops, young kids out there going, hey, go make arrests. Get these taggers. It was interesting. So they unleash us citywide, and we go out and ride buses and watch kids take a Dremel tool to a back window. And those windows, I think at the time, they were thick. Plexiglass.
Yeah.
They must have cost $400 a piece for a small section. So
These
kids were destroying those windows, and we'd go and nab those guys.
And
you know,
and fast too. I mean, the kids were they're really going to town on these RTD buses,
right.
And Metro Line buses.
Yeah. So the mornings or the afternoons, we'd go and get our five or six arrests of these kids. You know, and essentially, we'd take them back to the station, cite them, and have their parents come pick them up and say see you later, and that was it. Take all their tools away and take pictures of the backpack.
When you say their parents, does that mean most of them were juveniles or under 18?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure.
Any arrests stick out in your head?
So, yeah, there was a kid named Blue, and I'm sure he didn't spell it the traditional one. I think there was an umlaut and IEX or
you guys
something.
Had the box of crayons going down. He's like, nope, it's not this guy.
Right.
He's not spelling the traditional Crayola way.
Right.
Nope.
So he was bombing the hell out of MTA property and city property, and he was just all over the place here in downtown.
With somebody like that, do they get put on a list?
Yeah, well, I mean, the
you get more brownie points if you get somebody on the higher list.
Yeah, it was, you know, it was somebody to go and get because people were sick of seeing that name on everything, yeah. On, you know, on windows,
benches,
on
windows.
I think
chairs.
I think he did a car door, and for some reason that stuck out. It made people, you know, you see tagging on the side of a building, but when it's your, you know, Toyota Celica,
right?
This got bombed. You're yeah. like, damn there's it. Something. There's something personal about that, and I think somebody got mad about it. So they got us on the case, and one of our officers wrote a big, long affidavit, took pictures, got the evidence, you know, was able to prove who the guy was. And we went out and served a search warrant on him, got him, and, you know, he went to jail. And he's, right. he, you know, paid restitution for it. It was a big deal at the time. And, I mean, it was a strange thing, too, because after we'd get these kids on the buses or on the street corners, you know, throwing up a little slap tag or something like that, we'd go to the Palms area or to some of these, they were abandoned parks and things like that, and parking lots. LA's kind of filled up now, but they would have big mural pieces there. And we'd go see, you know, who was the greatest artist around. And I can't speak for the other officers because they didn't really so much care for taggers, but I had a reverence for these guys. I just liked art, you
right.
know? So I liked looking at some of these things and what they were doing. And I kind of subscribe to the notion if you're taking a spray can and you're writing your name 60 times on a freeway underpass, that's ridiculous. To
right.
jail you go.
You're not getting enough attention at home.
Yeah.
Something.
So therefore, you got to go to jail?
So therefore...
So the good kids that do the good art should not go to jail.
Right. I definitely subscribe to that notion where, you know, the better the art, you should, you know...
They're going to pass.
The worse you are and you can't spell your name with the backwards E clever...
If I can do it, you're going to prison.
Right.
That's a barometer for good art?
Right. If the LAPD or if the officer can...
Yeah, match, if the average cop could...
Can match your tag for tag, you're going to jail. You're going to get locked up. That's
so,
that.
Yeah, we'd get some of these kids, and I felt bad for them because, you know, some of them were fatherless and just looking for – they didn't want to be in a gang.
Right.
You know, so this was one way to express themselves, and it was
– I have no problem. I think the city – I don't think the city's doing a very good job nowadays of keeping tagging and
artwork. It's working hard.
No, I'm just – look, we could step outside, and, I mean, there's you can just turn around, do a 360, and it's fucking everywhere. I mean, now, is it good versus bad, you know? I mean,
like no, it's bad, dude. There's no relativism in this. If it's a shitty bomb all over the side of a building or on a sidewalk,
it's
bomb. Awful.
Yeah,
you know what? And it makes you feel bad. But if a business commissions a good artist to throw something
that's
up.
That's happening a lot more these days.
Thank God.
Yeah.
It's happening a lot more.
Absolutely.
Because and there's rules to it, too. The taggers won't write on that unless they knew the rule is it has to be bigger and better. If you're going to cover something up, that's the rule.
It depends on what area you're in. I mean, there's still taggers and there's still crews they don't give a fuck, you know. I mean, that's their neighborhood, that's their wall. And
yeah, so there's a gang mentality to that. And in fact, taggers or street artists, graffiti artists, whatever, they, you know, we got them into the Cal gang system because a lot of these cats you'd arrest and they'd have Saturday Night Special
and Priors.
And you know, you'd arrest them and you look across the street and their friend was on the roof with a, you know, some rifle just
right.
in case some
lookouts
gang, yeah, lookouts. So they were dangerous, you know.
Yeah.
Not all of them, of course, but some of these kids were.
Yeah.
And that was that. I had a good time.
So have you ever had to when you were I don't know if I'm remembering this correctly, but weren't you were you not injured on a chase down during your undercover days? Were you not
yeah,
injured?
Yeah, the old Sears building. I remember there was these guys by the railroad tracks, and they were tagging something, and there was no way to sneak up on them. It was just like, okay, guys, well, we got to get them now, or they're gonna. Well, we got to go. Let's now, and they start running. So we're like, hey, freeze, LAPD. And we're all kind of getting older and fatter, and these are young kids. And they're running on the ballasts, on the rocks on the railroad tracks.
Sure.
So my friend in front of me, Mark, grabs a dude, tackles him. And for some reason, as I was jumping to tackle him, he kind of turned around and said, no. And I kind of fell on the rocks and on him. Boy, those rocks don't give at all. There's no play in them.
No,
I mean, it is like jumping onto concrete. So I essentially cannonballed onto this pile of rocks, and he felt it. That's what he's kind of telling me, like, don't, no, this was a bad idea. Don't do this.
We're both going to get injured here.
Right, so that's, I busted up my knee, and that was.
Is that your only injury on the job?
I have a back injury as well.
How'd you?
It doesn't sound like the story is as exciting, though.
That's not. You know, I heard it during training. No big deal.
That's a train. That's
but
not a back.
I'm better now. I'm ready to go.
Right.
Let me just do this. Let me stretch real quick. Hold on. I'm not hurt. My back is not hurt.
So let's get into what this gentleman does now. Unless you had some other stuff.
No. We can jump. Mm-hmm. Let's jump into what your specific title is now. What you're doing for LAPD.
LAPD finally figured out that you got brains in there, and they wanted to use your brains instead of your bronze, right?
Okay. Yes. Well, thank you.
But the bronze ran out. The brains have always been there. Yes?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Bron ran out?
The bronze is gone. The brains have been there. Right? Let's do some push-ups? Huh? Let's see how many
push-ups. Push-up contest.
Pull-up bar. We got a pull-up bar.
Come on. Yeah, we got a pull-up bar. Oh, it seems like, fuck.
Damn it.
So when did LAPD figure out you're smart?
Let me write that down.
What's up, buddy? When did LAPD figure out you're smart?
Let me put that in parentheticals. Smart. Remind me to... kill Scotty.
I'm telling you guys,
they have never felt I was smart.
He's profiling all of us.
You know what? I think they were sick of me enough because I complained about working on the streets long enough. They just said, well, put him somewhere inside.
I mean, you're like the one cop that wanted the desk job. I mean,
I did. You know, I'm not cut out for the streets.
You know,
man.
Riggs and Murtaugh, right? I mean,
I'm a Cagney and Lacey's more little, like little sister. You dig?
I dig. So what is it you do exactly for LAPD
what
now?
What do you do here?
So now I work at LAPD's audit division.
Okay.
And it's Squaresville, man. It is.
It sounds like it. I mean, you need to fucking say it. But, I mean, just the word audit, right? I mean, but no,
right.
Come on,
nobody.
But what do you do there?
We do performance audits. Yeah, you remember this big Rampart scandal?
Football? Is that a guy involved in it? Wasn't there a guy named Football?
Jimmy Dean Rampart.
Yeah, Jimmy Dean Rampart, a football. And
yeah, Woody Harrelson was in the movie about it, right?
Right. They surfed, you know.
Right. Okay, so you surfed. You had to get that thrown in. Everybody, Jason lives in Huntington Beach area. He surfs on like probably 2 to 3 days a week.
No, not anymore.
So basically, he's just collecting surfboards. He just collects surfboards now, yes?
I know. I stare to collect dust.
Yeah, I see it on your Instagram.
It's tough. I went the other day, and boy, that is a perishable skill, brother. If you don't go all the time, it's tough on the shoulders. Getting old.
You are getting older.
You're older than me.
Yeah, I am older than you.
So you get to tell me what to do?
But look at this hair. Look at this hair, though. I mean,
I can't believe you still have it.
Look at that.
Dude, it's all there.
Jesus.
Okay, so what do you do at the audit division?
Performance audits.
Okay, what does that mean?
Okay, here's what it means. I will go to the aforementioned hazmat unit. And hazmat has a standard operating procedure that they developed over years of this entity being in the police department.
Got it.
And it's best practices and federal law and all these different rules they have to adhere to. I will go to them and say, look, we're going to audit you guys. Let me have your standard operating procedure. I'm going to review that, and then I'm going to make sure you followed your own rules. And we'll look at it's weird. You can't see the forest through the trees sometimes when you're in it. But if I look at everything they've done over a course of 6 months, I could see where their deficiencies are. I could see where they're doing really well. And I could take that. And what happens is I'll take that report. I'll write it all out. I'll discuss it with them. I'll go, look, you guys are having problems in this area. And they'll go, oh, no, dig it. I have something to support the reason why you found that deficiency.
Anomaly. Yeah, got it.
So they'll fix it, and then we'll fix the audit. And then we could take that audit, go to the police commission. Police commission is the ones that want this audit. And they want to review it and make sure that LAPD is doing the job they're supposed to be doing. And I get to take this shining report and say, here, police commission, our hazmat unit, best in the country. Read it and weep. And they read it and go, awesome, next item. We could look at the gang units. We look at different entities within the city, wherever there may be a need or not, and find out what the deficiencies are or what they're doing right, and then expand on those.
So I watch too many movies. And
right.
That's where this question is going to come from. Are you internal affairs?
No, completely different.
Thank you.
Audit division kind of transcends internal affairs.
Okay.
So well, I could go to internal affairs and audit them and find out what they're doing
wrong. I just wanted to make sure you were still liked. No, in the movies, they don't like internal affairs.
Dude. Bullshit. That's nobody likes audit
submissions. That's what I was going to ask
you. I'm loved.
Yeah, loved. Do you find that people in other departments are kind of like, oh, fuck, here comes the audit department and whatever your division is?
Yeah. You know what? It's just nature of the beast now. They know this is how it goes. We got to have an audit shop.
This is coming.
Yeah, we were under a consent decree from the Department of Justice for many years. You know, it was 10 years or something like that after the Rampart scandal. So we had to have this place that does audits and inspections of our own department to make sure that we're doing things right. I mean, it was a mandate. So we did, and now we're doing really well. And the audit division, my boss is just a great dude. You know, he's a civilian auditor, and it's just a good place to be, man. Yeah. It's a really good place to be. And what it does is it saves LAPD civil liabilities. So if we find something going on wrong, we could point it out prior to something bad happening and saying, hey, look, this is what's happening.
Try to get ahead of the problem.
Yeah, so there are different commands within the city. To answer your question, yeah, people hate getting audited.
I mean, just in general, people don't like getting audited.
Oh, dude, it's awful.
That's what I'm saying.
I want to get in your business. What are you doing? You know,
stay out of my business.
What color underwear do you wear?
You know what color they are.
Blood red. That's right.
So who does all the auditing for the mustaches? Do you go in and performance check like whose cop mustaches are looking the way they're supposed to be, or
right.
you're too light, too right. heavy?
So I'm the standard for cool mustaches.
You are standard. There's a gauge. There's a book.
Right. So the Coast Guard comes in, checks mine out.
I was gonna say who audits you?
Right. So they'll come in. They'll say, look, you're good to go.
Coast Guard.
Admit, though,
Coast Guard. Fire department Coast have Guard. The best mustaches.
Oh, God. Those guys, they're all full of testosterone.
Look at the mustaches.
The chicks like them.
The captain on the PCP cook-off, that guy's name is Dusty something. Captain Dusty.
Dusty mustache?
Dusty, but that guy had the chop. I mean, that was a good mustache on
yeah,
that captain.
Yeah, I'm just starting. This is a day and a half.
There's only a day and a half, huh? Day and a half.
Right.
So, okay. But let's be honestly. So, how long have you been in the audit division? How long and you like it there? I mean,
dude, I like
it's 9
there.
To 5, right?
It's a 9 to 5er. Yeah, and it's weekends and holidays off, and it's good. I get to know different people in the department. I go everywhere,
right.
All over the city.
Right. Your department's got their hands in everything, like you said. You guys are like watching and taking care of business on everybody else's business.
Right. And you know, the thing about our division is that when you go do an audit, people, there's two things they could go, I can't stand you guys, get out of here. Or you could just comply easily and we could get this done and you could see what you're doing wrong and you could see what you're doing right. And, you know, we accentuate everything that's going right. We magnify that. And really,
right. You could, yeah,
you could shine a light.
Yeah. They forget that you're on their side.
Right. So we want to shine a light on us. I want everybody to get 100%. Yeah. You know, but if they don't, then we could talk about it and figure it out and find out what's going on. But
yeah, have you encountered some like super hostility in departments or like
yeah.
I mean crazy bad like get the fuck out of here
a
like,
little bit. I mean, like you get that sense, and then somebody calls somebody. My boss talks to their boss, and then all of a sudden,
down.
Yeah, everything's
right,
okay,
right,
and
right,
we're
right.
all friends, and it's you know fist bumps and hugs. But
fist bumps and hugs.
You know what? Now we've been around long enough that people know it's part of the game.
Right.
And, you know, a lot of divisions audit themselves. So they could say, well, when...
Let's keep Jason out of here.
Let's just audit. I want that clown in here. Fucking mustache. Look at his mustache. Good God, it's awful.
That's funny.
Jerks.
No, jerks. We're not jerks. We're just mustache-loving dudes.
You know, what's up with you clowns? I mean, you're running around town.
Strangers don't have mustache. Well, Scott can get a good mustache going, but I've always not been able to do the mustache. I can't do the mustache. It doesn't work for me.
Dearborn's trying.
Dearborn, how's your mustache coming in? Yeah, yep, there it is. Freaking Boston mustache, huh? Huh?
I like these guys.
Yeah, they're great. Terry and Dearborn have the new add-ons to my friendship in life.
Terry? Is he okay over there?
Yeah, Terry is great over there.
He doesn't have a soft mat to stand on.
That's no, you know, fuck, we got to get him a soft mat.
Hit up Home Depot. Grab one of those silicone mats.
He's it's auditing us on, right now.
He is auditing
I'm
us
I'm trying
right
to help
now.
Here. It's heaven on your knees, kid.
Huh?
Hey, I have a question the for the auditor. When's the last time you carried handcuffs? Right?
Well, hey, listen. I still get in uniform and I work. I worked the Grammys the other night.
Oh. involved.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, I got in full uniform. Was out doing that.
Handcuffs are part of that, right? Obviously.
The handcuffs are part of that gig. I got to oil them because good God.
Yeah, good God, you know they don't get any use.
Just, yeah.
No, but that's a good jumping off point to what I want to ask you is, okay, so you got in uniform recently, and you do it every now and then. You'll go to work in uniform, right?
I worked Rams games and USC games in uniform.
So doing this job.
How does that work? Because you've been there for a while, or do you sign up for that?
Yeah,
or?
You could sign up for it.
It's called overtime.
It's called overtime.
That's like the gig.
It is a gig. It's you know what? That's 10 hours on your feet. It ain't that easy.
Right.
Not at my age.
No,
not at your age. You're going to talk out the side of my mouth.
So
call the police.
So then...
I'm having a stroke.
Back to my reference of when Scott and I are out, I will just say, and I don't know their names or badge numbers or whatnot, but there are a handful of cops out there that don't look, one, very well trained.
Okay.
Two, a little overweight.
Oh.
And do you guys have like a – do you guys need to get to the gym?
What do you mean by overweight? Like, are you a doctor? How do you know – they're overweight. That's their body type. Well, they're endomorphs.
The endomorphs?
What are the body types?
No,
Google
it. Google it. No, I just say that...
To the internet.
There is a lot of, what I would say, cops that look like out there, sometimes that are a little out of shape. You know, and I mean, aren't you...
mostly the older ones that have been doing it for a while and haven't moved out of the car.
Yeah, do you have a policy? Like, how often do you go to the shooting range? Since you're auditing, and you still your license to carry
you're
that
still
gun.
Still training, right?
Once a month.
Once you have to go to the
training. Is that mandatory?
Yes.
Okay. Is training mandatory? Like firefighters train every day. Do you guys have mandatory training?
Firefighters go to Costco and make lasagna every day.
Hey,
too.
It's good lasagna too.
I bet it is. God, I was so jealous of those guys. We'd go write reports in the station.
But do you have to? Are you?
Do there, I have to work
is
out?
Is that no, what no, you're no, we're not asking if you have to work out. We're asking you if you have to train. Todd's asking you if you
train
have to work
out. Train in what? Yeah, there's a lot of disciplines to train in. Train in
shooting, working out, staying physically fit.
Okay,
running, jumping.
So part of Chief Beck's kind of mission was to have a physically fit police department.
And everybody needs to learn how to ride a motorcycle.
Right. That's right. He loves that motorcycle. Gosh darn. I wish I knew how to ride one.
So you can
hang
out with
him? Teach me how to ride a motorcycle?
Will you teach me how to surf?
Yes.
I don't want to.
There's sharks out there, Todd.
I know. I don't like the fish. The fish is no good with me.
A lot of monsters out there.
Right? Yeah. Syringes, oil slicks, right? There's all kinds of shit out there.
Like Haiti.
Right. Brought to you by Haiti.
Right.
Vacation
Haiti
spot.
Surf vacations.
Haiti surf vacations. Brought to you.
All right. Listen, next sponsor.
Next sponsor. Do you work out? Do you keep yourself physically fit?
What are you talking about? Do you work out? Look at those arms. No, look at that chest.
I'm asking. I'm asking.
I try to. So yeah, for the audience, it is encouraged that police officers do that. The only problem is, after a 10-hour day and you start the violins, like it's tough. You know, mentally, it's hard on police officers to work because your head is on a swivel. You're constantly alert, and that amount of adrenaline pumping through your head all the time. It takes its toll. So a lot of guys just want to get home, crack a beer, and put their feet up. Like this, you need to decompress. Yeah. Right. I mean, you guys are at it too.
We do the same thing. We work hard at night, and then we'll go drink a beer in the morning, and go to bed.
Right.
And,
but you're right though, Jay. The head on a swivel and the adrenaline rush of being in at scenes that are chaotic, and you got to be ready. And whether it's still like an active shooting scene or there's still
like I said, they do a great job not killing somebody every night.
whether it's a car or an accident scene where you're still trying to block off and you're waiting for so cars don't come in. It's like I said, it's I get what you're saying. It's a tense. You're constantly tense doing the job.
Yeah, it's
so you just want to relax.
You do, and going to the gym after that is. It's a tough thing to do. So Chief Beck really wants everybody to be, physically fit, in shape, playing sports, doing that thing. The only problem is getting that done after work and then getting to family or getting home it's incredibly tough. So we start this diet thing every year. It's like a fitness challenge. And we have that in July to, I think, Halloween or July to August. October 1st or something like that, where people lose weight, they get on a diet, they start running, they actively do it. That's about the only time of year we really focus on officers' health. And they can participate or not, and there's big prizes and things like that at the end of the year.
Big prizes, everybody.
Like Sony televisions.
Right?
and whatnot.
Do you guys still have that softball? Like, do you guys go against the fire departments?
Oh, yeah.
Football games and, you know, flag football?
Yeah, my buddy Jerry at work, he's all into the softball playing for
against
LAPD.
Against the fire departments?
I think they play against fire departments, other police departments, things like that. Like,
are you joining the surf team?
No.
There is no surf team.
There is a surf team.
LAPD has a surf team?
I don't think so, but they have a surf But they should start one, right?
Right.
No,
how
you should
that?
Start one.
I'll start one. I'll start that. Let me write that down. Surf team.
Beck.
Take this all. Take all this.
Mustache required.
For a surf team.
You got to be mustachioed.
Oh, man.
Yeah, so physical fitness is important. And, you know, it's such a personal thing. So you see a cop that may be a little sloppy, you go, what's going on there? And if you took a cross-section of police officers, I'd probably be pretty equal to any other.
No, I think Scott was right. I mean, it's sometimes, most times, it's the older ones. I mean, I do see it. There's a lot of cops out there on the beat that I see that are physically fit.
Yeah.
Do have the big stretched arms and, you know, they've got their uniform.
Deion Joseph.
Yeah,
have you seen that?
Screaming, just
Officer
screaming.
Joseph down at, is it Joseph? I think it is. He's like the angel of Skid Row. The cop's like, you know, sent from God. He's like an angel, this guy. And he goes and works Skid Row, and he's been there. He's been a fixture there for at least 10 years. He's a senior lead officer. Anyway. Good Christian kid. You guys should probably get to meet him.
We might know.
Him over.
Our interview next week might know him.
Yeah, actually, we're having next week, we're having some guy by the name of Skid Row General Jeff.
Oh.
Do you know who he is?
No.
Do you know the guy? Yeah, I just got a hold of him.
He's one of the characters down there?
No, he's not a character down there. He's, I guess you could say, well, we're going to find out.
He's one of those clowns running around down
there? He's their, like, their
I love the guy.
Their confidant. Like, I mean, he's like their spokesman, you know, for what's going on in the Skid Row area, you
good.
Know?
Good.
He'll tell you numbers and tell you the companies that are just, they're making money, not helping and things like
that's
that.
Such a,
so he, yeah,
that's going to be interesting. Yeah, I can't wait to hear that.
He's basically got a, you know, he's trying to put a big spotlight on the homelessness problem down in Skid Row, and he's saying that there's a lot of things going on that on the surface look like they're helping and they're trying to put a dent in this homelessness problem, and he's like, I'm saying I don't think that's necessarily true, and I'll tell you why.
So, I'd love to hear that.
Yeah, so he's going to be our guest next week, so
awesome.
Looking forward to that.
Somebody interesting, not like me.
Yeah, somebody interesting in here.
I have a real quick question. It's kind of going back to how you started. You started Metro or MTA and then LAPD, and now it looks like that's changing back. What happened yesterday?
Okay, so I'm not too clear as to what happened, but we think that the MTA contract's going to be awarded back to LAPD come July. Sheriff's Department getting out of
that. Not just LAPD, also Long Beach PD. So if a transit runs through their city, they're going to take it.
Right.
Right now, if a transit train runs through Long Beach, the sheriffs handle it.
So this is an interesting thing, because through Compton, who would handle that? Would it be the Sheriff's Department within Compton, or does LAPD run down
on what part? Right?
There's city boundaries, and then there's other.
Right there. That's the KTLA thing about it. That's just a quick revise of what was going on. It was an LA Times article that's on KTLA.
Los Angeles and Long Beach Police Departments are going to have enforcement duties.
Yep.
Exciting.
Right?
I'm in.
So then what does that mean? Is that are they going to be creating a new division, or are you guys just
They will have a whole new division specific
basically to, going back to what you used to do in the beginning. There'll be a new MTA division of police officers that are basically just kind of solely going to their beat during the day will be the transit areas.
That's right. And there's enough of us still around to kind of train these guys that come
gonna,
in.
I was going to ask, are they going to ask you to do that? Are you going to be involved in this?
I've been getting emails here and there from other guys saying, hey, are you going to jump aboard? What's going
on
here?
This?
I probably won't.
Could be your swan song. Like, you know, your exit. You know, you can
comes
really
full circle.
Exactly. Born again.
I can understand why you're not going to go sit on the trains, but training wise, are you going to be training?
Yeah, I'll be over there. If they ask me to help, I'll certainly help. It's why not? But you know, things have changed too, so I don't know what the new standard in tactics are. And
I don't think the kids are bringing Dremels on the trains anymore or the buses.
They're not
smaller tools, much smaller tools now.
Laser guns etching now.
Laser etchers.
Aren't we supposed to be flying? Isn't our buses supposed to be flying? It's 2017.
Where's our jetpacks?
Yeah, no kidding.
Where's our jetpacks?
Railroad tracks.
They're coming.
railroad tracks are so fucking 1995.
I want to have a roast beef prime rib meal in a pill.
Right?
Do you remember that?
Right. Jetsons.
Invent that.
Invent Jetsons.
So I would go back. I would go help. And, you know, if they have slots open on an overtime basis, I'm sure they will. There's no way they could fill a division that'll need 300 or 400 people, like, overnight.
Right.
We just don't have the police power. I was going to say manpower. I'm trying to get away from the policeman, police.
Woman.
Woman. Right. It's police officer. So I would say manpower, but.
Do you know how
people
many
people power? Power. We don't have the people power.
Do you know how many women you guys have on the LAPD force?
I think we're up to 30% female officers.
Really?
Yeah, don't quote me on that. As of 2012, I don't know. I'll check on that. I'll come back next week. So push that other guy back a few, and I'll come back with the stats. So you need number of women.
Yeah, yeah.
Number of.
We need the Coast Guard here. We want the Coast Guard here checking mustaches, too.
I could bring them in.
That's great.
That'd be a great interview for you.
That's hilarious. Homeland Security talk. I have to talk with.
Yeah.
Do with you those guys. Are you involved? Do you know how many? Before you came in, I sent you that article to read about that guy that and he. Did you read the article about the algorithm?
Yeah, that's pretty cool, right?
Yeah, this guy invented this algorithm. He's a researcher guy. He's just basically a data researcher, and he was investigating, helping these small towns investigate serial killers, and if you know there was a way to kind of basically pattern and kind of right
so
catalog what am I trying to say here? What makes this,
their MO?
Their MO basically.
Yeah. So what they would do is take the crime stats over a course of 10 or 15 years and see what the trends are. And you do that by seeing what the weapon was used.
Duct tape. Yeah, that kind
duct
of thing.
Tape. It, you know, knife, tools of the crime, knives.
Strangulation.
And the MO. He grabbed a prostitute, threw him in the van, killed her.
Right. Or high school the girls, van, prostitutes. Right. Like, yeah, all these stats. And this guy, he would compile all these. And at the time, he wondered if police agencies or nationwide were using this type of a system kind of to catch or kind of profile serial killers. And right, he found out, yeah. He goes, like, nobody, like a lot of police stations, little smaller police stations, like, you know, in Des Moines, Iowa, and, you know, Dallas and all that stuff, that he went to a lot of police stations, they weren't really, you know,
they talking, weren't communicating with each other,
communication with each other.
So the same type of murder could happen in one town and then the next town,
one town over, right?
But they wouldn't talk to each other and realize that maybe we have the serial killer, same guy doing this.
Serial killer
close. It's like Moneyball for
right,
serial killers.
That's what he said, right? The breaking down, that's the, he brought that, right. That kind of...
the stats.
The stats from the Moneyball movie about how, you know, just kind of, if you just kind of figured out what this guy was good at, what, you know, what time of night they were working.
It wasn't so much so you can predict, but it was just more that where everybody can communicate together and find out, or was it about prediction? Were you able to predict off of his...
Well, there weren't any predictions, but if you get enough evidence together from enough crimes, then you could have a pretty thorough readout on who this guy is, like or gal. Listen, I'm not sexist, man.
Right, right.
I'm not sexist.
But then but in the article too, he kind of brought up the bigger cities, and he's, you know, LAPD was one of the cities he brought up, and he said that, you know, overall crime is down. And the cold cases, right?
Right.
There's a lot of that stuff. You know, he was talking about the cold cases, and that's what interested him anyway. That's how this guy kind of got his name out there. He was trying to help with some cold cases.
Yeah, Zodiac. He's looking for the Zodiac killer.
Oh, haven't found that guy?
No, that's
Black Dahlia.
It's Jake Gyllenhaal, right? Isn't that the Zodiac killer?
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is. Yes,
he's also the Nightcrawler. He's also LAPD officer. Gyllenhaal's been a lot of things.
Yeah.
So
Donnie Darko.
Donnie Darko, right? Can you wait? Do you have time to explain that movie to me? You said you're always going to explain that thing to me, right? What is the Donnie Darko movie about?
I have no clue. Kid has nightmares, and then the rabbit comes, and then the plane crashes. Yeah, why'd the plane crash? Did he predict the plane crash?
And what? then his girlfriend that gets run over with the car at the end?
Yeah,
the Halloween outfits?
It was a rad film. It was visually stunning, but nobody could ever get it. And then the same guy, what's his name, Kelly? Something Kelly? He directed another film with a Rock in it right after that.
The Rock? Or
The Rock, as in?
Dwayne.
Dwayne.
Dwayne
the Rock.
Johnson.
A Rock. Yeah,
I don't. What
a
movie
rock star?
Mm. A rock from Hawaii. He's Hawaiian. Is that racist?
No. Did they call someone Hawaiian?
I don't know what the young kids are calling them nowadays, but I call them Hawaiian still.
But anyways, I was asking, do you have the LAPD, the cold case department and crimes, I mean, and violent crimes, do you guys, are we a safer city tonight, today?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah?
I mean, if you look at crimes, so there's some tricks done statistically. So there's less people in the 50s with about the same amount of crimes as there is today. Now there's more people with more crimes, but the percentage increase in crimes isn't matching the percentage increase with people. So for as many people that are in LA, city of LA, how many? 4 mil? Now, that's a lot of people together. The crimes are not as bad as you think. I mean, compared to other big cities, we're doing stellar. You know, Chicago looks like hell.
Right.
They're having a hard time right now. They're having a really tough time.
Why do you think someone like Chicago? I mean, the violence is crazy, and there's a lot of guns and a lot of young kids and gang banging and drug use. Yeah. But how do you fix a city like that? I mean, with so much, you know, there's such a division between.
I think
the
word is time.
The police force and
there is time. I think
just time.
You know what? From what I understand, that mayor and that police department just don't like each other. The police department feels like the mayor is selling them out and willing to do anything for a vote. You know, it's easy to go call cops, racist murderers, and all these other things when you see one incident over a course of a year after a million contacts with people. So I think when we looked at it, less than 0.1% of all our contacts in the city, over a million contacts, turned into a deadly use of force. So that's not bad. Yeah. Those are really good stats for us. I'll come back next week with the exact stats. I come back, it's like one out of two people are shot dead by LAPD. I was wrong last week, boys, about what I said. Remember that part?
Remember that part of the show?
Yeah. I have look to your left, look to your right. Every one of you will be shot by a Los Angeles Police Department.
I've been saying for a while, and I don't know if this stat is true, but I've been saying that I mean, this is going to be different. I'm going to talk county, not city. But
okay.
Somebody gets shot every day in L.A. County. And this includes the city.
Okay.
If
nobody by a police officer.
Just shot. Somebody gets shot. Yeah. If they don't get shot, if somebody doesn't get shot that day, two people will be shot the next day. Is that stat about right? Or somebody gets shot every day in L.A. County?
Do the math on that one.
Hold on. I do this job like a lot.
Right. So
pretty well. So I'm listening to scanners. I hear somebody being shot all the time or every day, but I don't listen to scanners every moment. So
right.
I've done a little bit of Howard Stern math in my head, and I believe a lot of people get shot every day.
Yeah, so they can't say somebody gets shot every day. They have to look at
I know. I can, though.
Yeah, you can. You could say that. So you could actually have a log. This would be an interesting thing for you to do. So if you listen to LAPD scanner only, you could say, I listen from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. in the morning. Every day – right at hash mark every time somebody gets shot or shooting in progress, and you'll find out. You could look at that on an Excel spreadsheet and calculate the percentage of shootings. Like, or do they go up in the summertime or do they not? That's part of auditing. We get to see. Yeah, you know it is because people are outside and the sun's out longer.
But no, I
so they take that stat as what they do is they capture statistically how many people are shot, like gunshot wounds at hospitals and through the Department of Justice and things like that, because, you know, there's a doctor that has to report on that and the police are there to report on that. So they take those reports over the course of a year. So on Friday nights, four people get shot, but during the week, nobody gets shot.
But it averages out.
But it averages out to 365 people a year will be shot.
Absolutely.
Or one person shot twice. Would that suck?
Does that happen?
Sure, it does.
Right? Yeah. Would you hate to be that guy? What about...
There must be a reason why. I mean, if you're getting shot, you know, twice on two separate occasions, there must
awful,
be a reason.
Dude. Yeah, the gun violence with these kids is...
It's pretty gnarly.
It's awful, man.
It doesn't even make the news now. That's how normal it is.
It's ubiquitous. It's just part of the day. And that's what Chicago's having a big problem with. It's gun violence. And, you know, they're a gun-free zone, but they still have guns.
Sure,
how does
they
that...
are.
Do you believe in the gun-free zones?
No.
No.
Absolutely not. I'm not even a gun guy, and I don't buy it.
Yeah, you got. I know you have guns.
I have a gun.
No. Okay. Well, you used to have guns. So you're telling me that you think that we're safer if, you know, people have firearms, the good guys that have guns. Would you kind of live in that kind of?
I don't know. You know what? That social experiment hasn't been done outside of like Arizona or Texas or some of those places. So we'd have to ask them. We don't really talk about that. Do they have a significantly less crime rate because
people are carrying?
Open carry.
They feel it better when they walk outside.
They do.
You feel a little more comfortable.
You know what?
A little more
safe. I would. If you're in a movie theater and somebody starts breaking out with a gun, I hope the guy next to me has one.
Well, you have one at that movie theater. You normally have one.
Right, but there's not a cop at every movie, at every showing, every theater.
Right, but you do. You carry yours mostly where you go day to day, yes?
Yeah.
Right. Even when you're off duty, you carry it day to day, right?
I do.
Or when you're doing interviews?
Perhaps.
Who knows? So you are, like you said, then you are that guy that is possibly in a situation where something like that would arise. You know, you knowing that you're holding, that you're carrying, that you could prevent that from getting any further down the road.
Yes.
Or you would try to anyway.
Here's the rub to it, though. I am confident in my firearm. I practice a lot. I'm decent at it. I know it forward and backward. I know what to do. I know what a combat situation looks like. So there is that. The only thing I would want people to know is how to use their weapon. Because if you just, you know, if you're my wife and you grab the gun and you're like, what's this? And pow, 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 pow. That's not good. That's,
sure.
You know, that puts civil liabilities on you and all this other stuff. So I wonder how they're doing it in other states. I don't know how well it would work here. Because we are so, like the Los Angeles Police Department is pretty hyper-vigilant. They are on top of it.
Yeah.
So a guy walking down the street with a firearm is going to get taken down.
Unless
everybody.
Not necessarily.
You guys didn't call the police when you should have.
Oh, no.
Do you know about the? I mean, obviously, I talked. Did you know that night that those two kids went out in the full army fatigues with long guns in Inglewood?
Yeah.
Did you know that I was like right there on the front lines with those guys?
I did not know.
Oh, yeah. You should see. Wait, it's got to pull up, man. This is some crazy shit, man. At first, I got to tell you, Jay, I was apprehensive to get involved with this, but.
I'll explain to him why Inglewood PD did nothing. You tell him why Inglewood PD did nothing.
Well, this is what only I heard from another cameraman. This is why this happened.
Who was interviewed by Inglewood PD.
And I've been, as a young policeman, I've been trapped in the same situation.
What do you mean?
It was Wilshire and Western. There was a guy walking down the street with a shotgun, and you could tell the shotgun was, you know, open.
Racked.
It was racked.
Yeah, but did he look like that?
No, he didn't. That's heavy, man.
Believe that?
That's me with that guy. That's me standing next to him.
Todd's recording him. Todd's talking.
You're a hero, Todd.
No, watch this.
The motherfucking 92. Fuck that. That's what they doing. Hurry up and kill them. Harp state fucking order. That's what they did. Why didn't they
basically
come and talk?
This guy is.
What was he saying?
He is emphatically stating that LAPD are fucking killers. That you guys don't give a fuck about. You know, his babies, their mamas, and they're, you know, basically, you know, got their boot on their neck, you know, and he's saying that you guys are, you know, basically they're killers. You guys are your department's killers, and you guys don't give a shit about, you know, any of us in the inner city. And so he's going on and he's going on. And in this particular area, he's like, right. He goes, if this was going on in Beverly Hills.
And these guys are watching this whole time. Here's Inglewood PD watching.
Yeah, this is Inglewood PD on the perimeter of what's going on. This is actually my first shot when I found out what's going on about what we're – this guy's pointing his gun at nothing, absolutely nothing. The area where this is where it's going on is blocks away.
So the reason why they're not doing anything?
Yeah.
They have a football stadium coming in. They're not going to ruin it.
Well, no. What I heard was – is what they
that's absolutely true, Scott. I'm going to write that down too. Move to Inglewood.
They were so happy when they came into your city. When they went out of Inglewood and walked across into your city and then drove, you know, more into LA. Inglewood's like, thank you.
Adios, muchacho.
Postcards, everybody.
And there's another dude coming. So two of these dudes show up.
Yeah, so there's two of these guys walking around. And
this
basically,
is heavy.
The reason why, Jay, I kind of start to feel a little comfortable is that this guy was ranting and raving.
Look at that.
He was ranting and raving
just
with.
Walking down the street.
Yeah, this is Crenshaw in 104th.
Who's homeboy on the bike?
That's I think that's another. He's another. What do you call him?
I know who he is. He's somebody you know who he is too, actually.
Anyway, he's
been
one
talked
of
about.
Yeah, we can talk about that guy off
he's
air.
He's from the South Bay.
All right, he's what you would call, I guess, he's another fellow.
How about I start a little outfit like this, boys, and I hire him, and we go head to head. We find out who gets better footage.
Well,
go ahead.
See,
you're getting
the back of this guy's head, and he's right next to him.
No, I'm right next to him. Look, I'm almost in this guy's backpack. Look,
what's in his backpack?
More weapons.
Ammunition.
Oh gosh, I wish he would have shot you.
No. So listen, I
did you just say?
That would be a cool. That'd be like, you're like, and then you got the camera like a GoPro facing you, and you just go.
But he doesn't mean like that, folks. He's like movie type and shooting. You know, like the whole thing be dramatic.
Oh,
like,
no! I want you dead.
Want me dead?
I'm kidding. No, I don't want you dead. I love you.
I was.
So here's his buddy.
Okay.
His buddy just showed up.
So this is the same kind of protest. This guy has. They have long guns. They're out walking around.
Yeah.
In fatigues.
Yeah. So now you see the spotlight on him from the airship. The airship's going on. But Inglewood PD is out on the outskirts. And what I heard was that Inglewood PD did not want to get involved because of they're waiting for LAPD to show up and help him out with this because they do have that nice big stadium coming in. And the less homicides and confrontations that they have, I guess, you know.
The less they're in the news,
the better the city's going to look on an overall appeal once that stadium.
Inglewood mayor goes to the chief of police. They have a closed door meeting. They get together. They go, look, you better tell your boys. I don't care if there are two armed gunmen walking down the street in the middle of the night.
You do nothing.
I want you to stand down.
Stand down.
And the chief says, sir, yes, sir. And they shake hands and they laugh maniacally.
Right. Exactly.
And then he goes to the roll calls and says,
look at him, Jay. So this guy's on the phone right now with 911, and he is emphatically screaming to them, going, you don't give a fuck about us. He's like, you guys aren't coming in to tell us we can't do this. And this guy kept fucking going on about the Fourth Amendment, the right to bear arms, the First Amendment. This guy was rattling off all kinds of shit. And I asked him,
the weapons to protect our people.
Are you back from service?
I'm still in service.
I hear you.
Hold on, technically. We are policing our neighborhoods. We don't want these old fays in our shit.
Yeah.
I hear you. You and your partner, how long you guys been home from service?
Been home for a minute.
Yeah, so Todd's walking with these dudes.
Yeah,
that's heavy, Toddy.
Yeah, it was crazy at first. Like I said, I was afraid. I was a little afraid at first, but then I realized that these guys were really had their argument was with the police department. So I figured I didn't think they were gonna shoot me or you know. But it could have went bad because then after we did have LAPD detectives come and talk to Scott and I at the house about this incident and. You know, they were kind of, they told me like, it wasn't very smart. I get what your job is. And I know that's how you guys make your money and all that. He goes, but this situation could have went really bad, really fast. And I didn't disagree with him. I'm just saying that I kind of realized within the first 15 minutes I was standing there that their biggest problem they had was with you guys.
Yeah, it wasn't him. It was you, Jason. They had a problem with you.
But this went on. So check this out. So this goes on for about 45 minutes to an hour.
Don't do this again. Don't stand next to these guys like this again. I don't want. Just don't.
I know. You know.
Listen,
I'm
not asking you.
No. You're telling me.
I'm telling you.
JJ, just.
They could have taken you hostage. No, like it could have got.
No, I know.
Taking that guy hostage.
Look at him. His perfect hair.
Right? I mean, they get a lot of money from me, right?
You
know, right?
You get a lot. How much do they?
I would ask Jason to come
back. The guy's like, we are not releasing the hostage unless we get $4 million. Listen. And then you just hear laughing, and we're like, wah!
Jason, if I asked you to come down and negotiate me out of this, you'd be the one to come down and negotiate me out of this situation?
Yeah,
for sure, right?
Absolutely. I'd like throw the cell phone across the street to the guy. He'd grab it. Yeah.
Yeah. We want the $4 million, the full $4 million.
And then, I can't give you $4 million. We got almost $13 between us.
Look,
and the guy's like, I'll take it.
Look, you're like, look, is Todd okay? I need to know. I need the proof of life. You're like, I know he needs hair gel. I'm going to slide you some hair gel across the street, okay?
Exactly.
And give that to him.
And when he's done putting it on, give him a good shot to the gut with that rifle butt. Make him know you're serious.
This guy, he was the scarier out of the two, this guy.
Yeah, he doesn't look stable.
Yeah, he was. I mean, and look, and then the people down Crenshaw, up and down driving, like this got crazy. And what? So, listen.
I hear you, dude. No, I'm not. I feel you, dude. I'm out here covering the truth, dude.
We fearless.
What is that, CPP rule? You can't get police on one kind? When these old faces do that all the time, they're heroes. How can't you police our own kind in our own land? Just remember, it's stolen.
It's a black flag. Fuck your Crips. You all have my kind.
So do you know how this thing ended, Jason?
Do you know? No.
So these guys got into a car. They're right
after
here.
About 2 hours.
Yeah, after being interviewed by multiple cameramen.
Channel 5 got down there. Channel 4 got down there.
So then they got in their vehicle and drove to.
That's Channel 5 Mike right there, the guy in the beard. He works for Channel 5.
They got in their vehicle and drove to the valley, to their very nice gated community.
Right. Oh. They weren't even in. They're not from Inglewood.
They just drove down Crenshaw to make some business, and then they went to their gated apartment. At this point, LAPD found out where they were. They surrounded and they followed them. And about 2 hours later, they did a felony stop and took them in custody with those rubber bullets that you were talking about.
Right.
Got them right in the face. I don't have that. I'd have to go to the other footage.
Yeah, the one that
I went home. I mean, by the time all the helicopters and all that, because Todd started it, and then. Once he started following it, I caught him right at the 10 and the 405, and I said, I got it. You feed your footage, because we had competition.
Yeah.
So I went and finished the rest of it. This is my footage now. I finished this part where Todd sent out the first, and I'm like, no, you don't need to come out here. So I finished it, but all the helicopters came, all the ground crews came, and I'm like, well, what am I doing?
That's here? Heavy, man.
I'm going to go home. So eventually, about a couple hours later, daytime came, and they took these guys into custody.
Yeah. It's a strange thing. I mean, I'm not too well-versed in the law. I should be, but for a while, I knew that an empty rifle can be carried about. Like, there's nothing wrong with that.
Sure.
Hence, rifle racks in cars and things like that.
But when we got interviewed, I was checking out the gun. The dude had a full clip. The guy had a clip in there. Yeah, I know he had a firearm, his sidearm on his belt
And he did ask the detective when they were interviewing us, was it loaded? And they both said, yep.
Yep, it was loaded. So the dudes had live ammunition on them. And so that's the thing.
That changes the game.
That's back to what we were saying. Like, Ellie, you know, back, you know, how this got started. You can't just carry a gun down the street and get away with it. Well,
or can you?
Or can you? Because these dudes, I mean, yeah, they got arrested eventually, but.
Right, so we
got
to get to the bottom of that. Why didn't Inglewood PD do anything? But, you know, once again, maybe they were just letting them cool off. Maybe they knew they were having a protest moment, and they wanted to let them protest.
Those two guys did call and say they were on their way down there to protest whatever it is they were protesting.
They were calling it a protest. They said this is a peaceful protest. But when you're in full army fatigues and you're carrying long guns that do have live rounds in it.
You also think multiple people when you hear protest, not two dudes.
Everything revolves around reasonability. Everything. You know, you hear stories about this cop shot this dude for no reason. Well, it's not usually no reason. I can almost promise you that. It's almost usually no reason. What happens is if a police officer pulls you over and it's the middle of the night and you're scared and he's like, keep your hands on the wheel, is it reasonable for you to start reaching under the seat and going in the glove box and telling him to fuck off? Telling her to fuck off?
Telling them?
Telling them to do whatever. You know, go pound sand. That is not reasonable. A reasonable person would not do that. Reasonable people like you, Scott, and Todd, and the others, would not reach under the seat for anything if a cop was screaming at you to keep your hands on the wheel. Now, you have every right to sue that police officer or complain about that police officer if you feel your civil rights were you know, messed with, but... At that moment, just do what the cop says, and
you can figure things out.
I promise you, it'll end up good.
Right,
unless you have a warrant or whatever.
Right, it's going to end up not being. Someone's not going to get shot. But that, like you said, that's what happens. Is people get heated up in the moment, and they're like, "You don't have a right to fucking pull me over.
Right.
You don't have a right to talk to me like this."
Everybody's a lawyer.
Everybody knows this
Especially
or that.
With their phones now.
But what they don't know is what the cop has heard prior. This guy in a red flannel shirt driving Miata? Peach Miata.
Peach. Was last seen southbound.
Right-hand drive, by the way. He got it from Europe.
Right.
So, driving down the street, I mean, just tearing it up. And we
fit the description.
Yeah, fit the description. And we pull you over. And then you're like, hey, why'd you pull me over? I'm just cruising my Miata. You know?
Top down.
What's up with that?
Right.
you could be pissed off and you could start going to the seat or getting out of the car and like getting in their face. But what he knows or she knows is that you committed a crime or are about to commit a crime. Right. So it's touchy. It's scary, dude. And, you know, all they do with cops, all they do with us is show us videos one after another of cops getting shot, cops getting in fights, cops getting beat up, all this stuff in the name of officer safety and training. So you see that all day. There's a form of – and I don't want to marginalize or diminish people that go to war and, you know, our brothers and sisters that come back with PTSD. They got it in a short amount of time. We have like this extended version of it. You know what I mean?
Day in, day out,
over the course of 12 years, reading reports that have rapes and robberies and murders and mayhem all the time.
Stick ups, 211s, all that good stuff.
Right.
Yeah, I was going to, when you were talking about physical shape, I was going to bring up mental shape. So what mental shape do you guys end up with, or how do you end up on the right side of it instead of on the bad side of it?
You know, there's always a push in the department to say, hey, go see. We have in-house psychologists at behavioral science section. Officers have to go see them when they get in a shooting or a major use of force to make sure that everything is okay. Like, hey, you're going to be okay. I hope you're okay.
Officer-involved shootings, after an officer-involved shooting, you guys always have to go and talk to
a psychologist
officer.
Correct. So they are also free to use for us anytime. I'm going to have to see one today after this because you guys are making fun of me and my mustache.
No one's doing that.
No, you are. I know you are.
We're going to call the Coast Guard and make sure that thing's on the up and up when you're gone.
Go ahead, Todd. I don't care.
We're going to.
No, wait, don't.
Don't.
Get on the phone.
So do you ever go see the psychologist?
I have, yeah. You know, when things got heavy for me, you know, after a divorce, I was like, I don't know. Am I okay? Like, what's going on? I need to figure some stuff out, and just talking to somebody once or twice really helps.
Absolutely.
You could compartmentalize some of your issues.
Do you think the police department, do you think enough guys are, you know, do you think enough of them are using that?
I hope so.
Yeah.
I hope so. It's never bad, and there is no stigma to it anymore. It's not like 1960s America anymore. You get to go see somebody.
We should all go talk to somebody at times.
It never hurts.
Right. No, it doesn't. Do you know how many officers are in your force?
10,000?
Yeah.
Is that right?
10,000 strong?
You. Oh, I thought you were.
No, I wasn't questioning.
I thought you had the answer,
Scott. I don't have the answer. To the internet.
Write that down. How many officers?
To the internet. Terry?
30% female. Yeah, that's what you're
saying. Is that what I said?
Is that what I said?
I think you said that, sir. And I don't know if you're right, but I will find out.
No, it's all this double talk. See, you cops are good at this, going, what did you say? What did you say?
What do you mean by you cops? Like, you Arab cops?
No.
That ain't cool either, bro. Write that down. Islamophobe. Is that a word nowadays?
It is Islamic. It's a word used a lot these days.
I'm not Islamic.
No.
But I know you fear them, so.
No, what? No, no.
10,000 police officers in 2015.
There you go.
Thank you.
Terry,
welcome. They're about to add some more.
Are they who?
Well, the new transit.
No, they're not going to get any more, but they're going to
start.
They're going to start filling in spots from other places.
You don't think they'll hire more?
I hope they do. It just, you know, that stuff is always a year behind. So we'll have empty spots for a year before we can get the funding for the next batch of police recruits to come in specifically for that or to start their own division.
How many in a class do they take out of the training academies by year to year? Do you know?
You know what? I've seen classes as small as 30 and some as big as 96 or something like that. So it depends on what they have funding for and what they're pushing.
Is the academy still up on the Chavez Ravine? Is that where?
Elysian Park.
Elysian Park. Is that a training facility?
It's a training facility. So the recruits first start out at Amundsen Recruit Training Center, ARTC. Is that what it is, Scott? Why can't you tell me?
He knows I don't know.
No, he knows everything. I know he does. And that's down in.
Well, I do have the internet in front of me.
How dare you not use that during the interview? And that's down in Westchester by the airport. So they start there. They start training there in classroom time and learning the job. And then I think the second half, they go up to the academy in the valley. Man, they're then three different places.
Mm.
Then Elysian Park. It's been too long.
I got a question. I've been wanting to do this. I just remembered something I wanted to do. The code talk, you know, when you guys are running down license plates.
Right.
Can you do your ABC? Can you do your ABCs all the way through?
Oh, how dare. I haven't done this in years.
Okay.
All right.
Let's go. Do it.
Adam, Boy, Charles, David, Edward, Frank, George, Henry, Ida, John, King, Lincoln, Mary, Nora, Ocean, Paul, Union.
What's? Come on. Come on.
Queen.
You said Queen twice.
You went from Paul to Union.
OP. Oh. Paul, Queen, Union.
No.
What?
A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L,
M, you have to sing
N.
OP. Ocean, Paul.
Ocean, Paul.
Q.
Queen, Union.
No.
No.
QR.
QR. Why am I going to you?
What is R?
Robert.
Robert.
Sam.
Tom.
Tom.
Is it Tom?
Is Tom? That doesn't sound right.
You got? Can you get them to start using Todd? Can we?
Write that down.
Right. Can we get the
Tom?
Union.
Young. Is it Young or what's Y?
Young. Victor. Zebra. Look at me.
What's the X? What's the X?
X-ray.
X-ray.
God, I missed like 10 letters. Is it too early or am I just not smart?
No, you are like now fired from the LAPD.
Were you using the Arabic alphabet? were you? I don't know.
All right, Trump. Is he president? Did he actually win?
Yeah, I think he
did. It's weird. When you see him on TV, you're like, there's Donald Trump. You don't be like, there's President Trump. I just keep going, look, there's Donald Trump.
Donnie T. Yeah, I still have a hard time putting the president in between it sometimes, I guess. It's like you said, it's just kind of weird.
Just known him as Donald Trump.
Donald Trump.
That's bizarre times.
All right, so that's a great way to end this podcast is with Donald Trump. I'm just kidding.
Yeah, no. Set the place on fire and then leave.
We do have to wrap it up, so I'll let you guys wrap it up here.
No, but that was great. I've been thinking about that sitting in the car working at night when they run in license plates, and I was like, right. I wonder if Jason could do the alphabet and remember what he had to do, because that's a lot of your basic training, right? When you're going through the academy, you got to learn all that stuff, right?
Yeah, I try to speak English as much as I can on the radio, but they need to know those letters for the alphabet.
I just know that I would be in, like, if I had to either report back the license plate or get it fed, I'd be like, fuck, what is the R again? Like, what is the R again? Like, I'd lose it.
Roxanne, Charlie, Zircon.
Zexon, Roxanne. Yeah. I would use old video games, like, you know, Zaxxon, Galaga, Pac-Man.
Zelda.
Yeah, Asteroids.
Zelda.
Oh, that's a good game. See if you could do that all the way through.
Well, we all did.
You guys are the best.
I mean,
I love this little thing you got going on, by the way. I like this little gig.
Yeah.
Thank you. I was wondering what you thought about all this.
I love it. Look at this place, man. It's right on the money.
Yeah.
Professional.
Well, yeah. Professional.
Who would have thunk it, right?
I would have.
I remember an old story that had to do with Officer Jason here. Todd and I were doing a photo shoot, and it was on the weekend. And usually when I get an idea in my head, I repeat it a lot. So I was repeating that idea a lot, and by the time, I don't know, morning came, Jason's like, enough about the photo shoot. I've heard it enough.
Right.
The good news is we followed through and we did it.
We did the photo shoot.
What was it?
It was the XXX photo shoot at Kurt's dad's place.
With the hot girls, yeah.
All right.
Kurt's dad's place. But yeah, I remember the idea came while we were hanging out, and like I said, I repeat my ideas a lot.
Scotty, you're a champ.
But we followed through. That's what I'm saying.
Do you guys still have the invisible coffee table?
What was that, 99?
No, we don't have the invisible coffee table.
That was 99. So 99, we were playing with that crap. And here we are 17, 18 years later still playing around. A little different, though.
Look, it doesn't hurt if you guys call me and want a beer every now and again.
Yeah.
It doesn't hurt.
Are you allowed to drink? Yeah, you can get a beer or two in you?
I mean.
Right? Firearm on the side, on the table?
It would be off-duty.
Off-duty drinking.
Utilizing an Uber or Lyft. Or taxi cab.
What's your preference on that?
I like Lyft.
You like the Lyft?
I do. Uber's like, everybody's into Uber, man. I'm not. I'm a contrarian, baby.
Right? It was such a big, just giant monster that dropped, you know, jumped into the scene. So, I mean, I kind of picked that up on you. You're like, let's use the Lyft. They seem like they're the guitar players, you know,
not the Uber, lead singer.
Uber's like the lead singer. Do you still?
They're this, not this, baby.
Do you still play guitar?
I just got an electric guitar too, because I sold off all my stuff because, you know, life. I needed a surfboard.
Another surfboard, you mean?
Another surfboard, one for every condition.
Right.
I know what you're talking about.
You dig it, right, Scotty?
So, when's the last time you played?
I think I got three.
I played last night.
Yeah.
Yeah, stood in front of the computer.
Do you still talk to any of the guys? What's the name of the band? North South? Is that
North
the
End? North. No, I haven't talked to those guys in an age. Everybody kind of went their own way, you know, doing their their thing.
That was a good band. I saw you guys a handful of times. You guys,
we did it.
You guys did a lot of good jams.
Weird thing watching, you know, 19-year-old girls jump around with little backpacks singing your songs. Yeah, they were hot, dude. They were all over me, remember?
No.
Yeah, dude, there was hundreds of girls.
What? Hundreds of them.
Do you remember I got in the limo and you had to push everyone off? Yep. That was
the limo.
Really,
I remember it all. Remember it all.
Which was a Honda Civic. There were no girls. But that's what I remember.
Jason, I really appreciate you coming in, dude. Let's do this again soon.
Thanks, Toddy. Yep. I would love to.
All right.
Boys.
Thank you, everybody.
Scotty and the guys.
Yep.
Yeah, man.
Was that good? Did you guys have fun?
Thank you so much, dude.
Scotty, thank you. That was